Let's say hello to tonight's guests. One of them is a West End legend who's been in everything from 42nd Street to Guys and Dolls.
Yeah, and the other is a brilliant actor whose latest film has just hit the big screen today. Please welcome Bonnie Langford and Timothy Spall. Bonnie, I hear you're a big Timothy Spall fan.
I am. I'm quite overwhelmed today.
Back at you.
I'm quite overwhelmed. Sixth Commandment for me was just the most glorious thing. I kept watching it and watching it. I just cried over it. That and Enchanted, which couldn't be too, you know, further apart if you tried.
Well, just look,
it's stunning. The range, Bonnie, isn't it?
It's quite a range.
She's pretty brilliant. Well, I mean, look, I was just telling Bonnie I went to see one of the first previews of Cats. When she was 16, I thought, bloody hell, and I'd seen her in other things. But bloody hell, she can really dance.
I mean, she really could. It was a long time ago.
She's great.
Now, lots of people this weekend, Timothy, will want to see your new film. I've been lucky enough to see it already.
Have you?
Bonnie, it is...
Is it hilarious?
It's fantastic, so funny, yeah.
I can't
right?
wait.
It's called Wicked Little Letters. Yeah. It's out this weekend. It's Olivia Colman in it, yourself, Jesse Buckley, a fantastic cast. Yeah. And it's based on something that really did happen in the 1920s. Now, before we talk about it, let's remind everybody of the story that gripped the nation.
It became known as the Seaside Mystery by newspapers as the Sussex town of Littlehampton was caught up in a dark and absurd scandal. Residents started receiving anonymous hate mail, and one person who was sent the most was Edith Swan. And she was quick to accuse her outspoken neighbour, Rose Gooding, who she wasn't too fond of.
She's heinous, and she's what we feared would come after the war.
Rose was later charged with a crime, and what came next was national uproar, as people tried to prove her innocence. But if it wasn't Rose, who was responsible for sending those wicked little letters?
So good. Now, Olivia Colman plays Edith. You play her father, Edward. I mean, what can you tell us about him?
Well, Edward is a classic example of the worst kind of Edwardian martinet. He's strict.
Yeah.
He's frightening. He's hypocritical. He's pompous. He's also kind of himself a little bit. You know, he's never come to terms with his own problems, put it that
sure.
way. But he has got this daughter who he is very protective of, a middle-aged daughter, who was receiving the filthiest letters.
Filthy
letters that he finds are reflect upon him. He cannot bear the fact that somebody's writing all these filthy... He's so incensed that he goes to the police station, gets the policeman back and ends up reading them out loud.
Yeah.
And he ends up shouting at the top of his voice the vilest things that I think anybody's ever had things said about them, really.
Well, right, we're going to have a clip now. But it was
not that
really
bit, probably.
Wasn't
no.
it? Well, it was difficult to find one without swearing,
yeah.
so we tried our best. This is what we came up with.
Some values might survive the trenches, Constable.
Another letter.
It's wicked abuse, this. Edith's not sleeping. She's grizzling all the night, bless her, in and out of bed. Now, I know my law. This is a prison offence. So you better do something about it, sharp-like, before there's a hurdy-burroo.
Now, obviously, we can't say what's in the letters.
No, please don't.
It's a family show and all the rest of it, so people will have to use their imagination. But it's quite surprising for a period drama, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it is, considering that you're used to seeing people dress like this, being, you know, very well-behaved and doing marvellous things and sort of looking like an ideal sort of Brit, really. I mean, this is really the underbelly of what's going on. I mean, the swearing, all the bad language, isn't just gratuitous, because it grows out, you find out, a real sense of kind of repression of females' potential, repression of sexuality, repression of all this age where the age is just tipping.
Yeah.
It's almost like an advert for how the whole thing's going to blow up. Now the new the suffragettes are going. My character can't stand that. He's lost two boys in the war. He can't stand. Many people can't bear this change, and this language, this filthy language, inadvertently illustrates the kind of steam that grows out of this hypocrisy,
yeah.
really.
Am I right in thinking you were surprised to find out that this was a true story?
Well, I was delighted.
Yeah.
It's brilliant.
I thought it was so preposterous. Yeah. When I actually looked it up, I thought, my God, this has actually happened. And then, of course, yes, like many things that sound outrageous, yeah, and the language. And, of course, we assume that we sort of invented it in 1960s or something, the swearing all of a sudden appeared.
Yeah.
It's been around since time immemorial.
Of course.
And then once that loses its taboo, even worse things come up or other things come up. You know, I mean, there's always going to be it. It's a way of, you know, punctuating and expressing things that are going on often in your subconscious. You know?
100%.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you can watch Wicked Little Letters, and it's definitely worth a watch in cinemas from today. Thank you.
Now, very shortly, we'll be joined by Grammy Award-winning singer Jacob Collier, who will be singing his stunning single Witness Me live at the end of the show.
We are looking forward to that. But now, we can't have you on, Bonnie.
What?
Without...
What have I done?
..mentioning the Doctor of the Who.
Oh, the Doctor of the Who.
Yes.
The Who of the Doctor.
Yes. You made a triumphant return, didn't you, for a 60th anniversary episode, which went down a storm. And the Doctor was very happy to see you. Let's have a look.
Oh, that's for you.
Good, good, good. Now, what have we got? Are these worldwide? Because I'm going to need all the statistics. Oh, no way.
Oh! That is the best news, Melanie! Hello!
We'll catch up later, we haven't got time. I used to be like you. I was one of his companions.
I wasn't the first redhead.
No, that was me.
Oh, fantastic!
That was me!
Bonnie, when we said you were coming on the show, we had so many questions.
Yeah.
We have to start this one from Cameron. It said, Bonnie, did you enjoy being back on Doctor Who? And are we going to see any more Melanie Bush in the future?
Yes to both.
Yeah.
I loved being back on it. It's you know, how many jobs do you do that you can come back and reinvent and you can sort of put things a bit right, maybe? Because when I was in it in the 80s, I was very sort of Faye Ray going, monsters! You know, didn't really have anything. And I was a computer programmer, which was sort of quite ahead of its time as such. Never went anywhere near anything remotely like a computer. So now I have a desk and I am in that office, you know, being what I need to be. And so, the new series starts in May and, I'm part of that.
Lovely.
But actually, it's Russell T Davies. I have to talk about him incessantly.
Oh, go on.
That's what he told me. I had to talk about him incessantly because it was on this programme. I actually sort of knew I was going to go back to it because we do these audio dramas for Doctor Who. They've been doing them for ages and ages, and so I've been participating in those. And during the pandemic, Russell found a audio drama that he had written when he was 23 for the sixth Doctor, Colin Baker, and for myself, for my character. And so we re-recorded it. And the week after we did that, he then sent me this email with the script for the giggle for Doctor Who and said, how do you fancy it? And I said, I'm beyond excited. But it was on this programme that I was sitting having my tea and watching him saying, oh, and yes, we're doing this audio drama and we've got Colin Baker and Bonnie Langford going to be part of it. And I just went, what?
So you found out the news
out
from the One Show. Brilliant.
Yes, amazing. Bringing people together.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
So we have to talk about Made in Dagenham.
Yes,
now,
you do.
Obviously, this is a brilliant film based on a brilliant true story as well. Give us a little reminder then of the background for the people who aren't familiar with the story.
Well, it was a film it's about the 200 workers, women, female workers that were at the Ford Dagenham plant.
Yes.
And they were going to be downgraded as unskilled workers. Mm.
Yeah.
And so, quite rightly, they disagreed with this because also their pay would go down.
Yeah.
And to cut a very long but very human and beautiful story short, that's how they got the Equal Pay Act, because they refused to take anything less than 100% equal pay, the same as the men.
It is an incredible story, but you're taking part in a one-off special on stage.
One night only at the London Palladium.
So why aren't you doing, like, three?
I don't know.
Fine.
Yeah, she's waiting for Russell T Davies to come on and tell her she is.
Yeah, exactly. Russell will come. So it was 10 years ago that the show... So there was the film about this story, based on the story.
Yeah.
And then 10 years ago, there was a musical in the West End called Made in Dagenham musical.
Yep.
This is the 10th anniversary celebration of that. Yep. We're doing it for one night only.
And who's joining you on stage?
Well, Pixie Lott, Killian Donnelly, a huge cast actually, Peter Duncan, Trevor Dion Nicholas, Katie Seacombe. I mean, it's fantastic. But it's a concert. So it is a sort of semi-stage concert. We're not doing the whole sort of thing, as in, you know, no sets and whistles and whatever.
Yeah.
You will see the orchestra and we will get up and hopefully get the songs right and hopefully get it all right. And I'm playing Barbara Castle.
I thought you
I'm
might.
Barbara Castle.
I thought
and
you
the
might.
Fiery redhead. So Barbara Castle was an MP who supported the women to get the equal pay, and
she was a powerhouse.
Oh, she was a fiery redhead.
Yeah.
I have no idea why they've cast me.
Now, I
no comment.
Yeah.
You went
move on. Yeah.
You're too nice.
Yeah. Performing at the London Palladium.
Yes.
It holds lots of memories for yourself.
It does. It's such a beautiful. Have you performed it?
Never. No.
Oh, it's such a. It's one of those glorious theatres that is beautiful, but at the same time feels like home.
Yeah.
And I've performed there many times. I performed. I performed there with the Pirates of Penzance with Paul Nicholas, and it was the week of the poll tax riots, and we had to be locked in. I've done loads of Royal Command performances there. I did one which was a special one for the Queen Mother, the Queen Mother's 90th. And they brought her round afterwards. And while we were waiting for them to come round, James Galway was in it, you know, the flautist.
Yeah, yeah.
And so were people like John Gielgud and Roger Moore and Michael Caine. And they had these top hats on. They'd been doing a number from My Fair Lady. So James Galway is just, he never stopped playing this flute. And they put one, they got the top hat and put it down and said, here, you might make a few quid while you're playing like a busker. You know, but yeah, so there's all sorts of silly things that have happened, but it's a very happy place for me. I'm going to be glad to be back there. March the 16th.
Yes. Wonderful. Yeah.
I think.
You're
I
doing
hope.
Our job for us.
That's
when
say,
I'm
yeah.
going anyway.
About to say it. Yes, the 10th anniversary concert of Made in Dagenham, very rightly, as Bonnie said, is on the Saturday, the 16th of March at the London Palladium.
Yeah. Mm. Now it's time to talk music with a hugely talented artist who's become one of the most sought-after collaborators in the industry.
Yes, Jacob Collier's become a force to be reckoned with. Now, before we talk to him, let's have a look at his Grammy Award-winning career so far, which he started after posting himself singing videos of covers online.
Flintstones, meet the Flintstones, down on Stone Age family. From the town of
Where's Timothy's pink jumper?
Yes.
Yes.
Come on.
You don't want to look. I'm wearing more than pink underneath. You wouldn't want to see it twice.
Oh, OK, I see. Jacob, the first album, right, was called In My Room, and there was a good reason for that, because it's where you recorded it. It's where it all began, right?
Yeah, I've got a beautiful little room in North London in my family home, and I made that first album. Now, I still make lots of music in that room, but that was a very much a sort of solo mission. And then since then, I've been collaborating vivaciously with people around the world and bringing some of those seeds back to the same room where everything began, which has been really a very exciting adventure.
But you won. I mean, you play it down.
Yeah.
You won 2 Grammys for that album.
That's true, I did.
What was that moment like then?
It was completely surreal, as you can probably imagine. You know, I sat in that room making things very much on my own terms, just throwing paint, experimenting, just being very interested by music. And then these 2 Grammys came along. I mean, the nominations were mind-blowing enough, but when I won the 2 of them, it was quite a staggering moment, to be honest.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, exactly. You win one, and then all of a sudden it goes, fancy another one?
Yeah, it was bizarre, but it was amazing at the same time.
Oh, so good. Well, look, you've performed all over the world, and Jacob's actually renowned for doing something pretty magical at his gigs. This is you, Jacob, at Glastonbury. Take a look.
Incredible thing you've seen.
Yeah.
Can you believe
imagine
it?
Being
we're
going to try it.
I wanted Jacob to do it on our camera crew. They've got some beautiful voices back here.
Oh, I can imagine. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. No doubt.
Visually, they're very talented, but vocally, I don't know.
I don't know about that.
No.
Jacob, musical talent obviously runs in your family. Your mum was. Is she still a conductor and a violinist?
Susie Collett. Yeah, she's a. Like living legend and definitely still a conductor.
That's what I mean. And has she inspired that idea?
I would say so. I mean, when I was a young child, some of my earliest musical memories were of watching her sort of spring her body into action and then 50 people would begin to play, and there's something, it's like casting a spell, mm-hmm. almost. It's something so beautiful about that process, watching it. And then I accidentally became a conductor of sorts myself, I suppose.
Yeah, and you play a ridiculous amount of instruments. Is that right? You don't actually know how many you play?
No, I can't say for sure how many. There are different families, I suppose, of instruments I'm interested in. There's the keyboard instruments, the guitar instruments, bass instruments, percussive instruments.
And are you learning it, or does it just come naturally?
I'm trying to work out.
I imagine your mum just being like, right, I need a little bit of this, and you're just like running to the other side.
What's
and just
the obscurest instrument you reckon?
Oh, I play an instrument called the ektar. It's actually very easy. It's from Bangladesh. It has one string, ektar. And you play it by squeezing the ektar. Goes.
Oh, I like the sound of that.
I'm sure. I mean, you Timothy would smash the ektar.
Oh, love it. I love it. Yeah, I'm gonna get one.
Get a pink jumper and then get an ektar.
New album. New album. Jesse is coming out. You've said this is 30 years in the making.
So this is the fourth volume of a quadruple album series. Volume one, volume two, volume three. This is volume four, and. On the album actually features 100,000 audience members singing, as you just heard, a little bit like that. It's a sound unlike I can describe. It's just this massive wall of humanity. Amongst some other of my more legendary friends in the music industry, Chris Martin, Shawn Mendes, Kirk Franklin, Brandy Carlisle, John Mayer, Michael McDonald.
A lot of names to pick up.
Those names are bouncing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, boom!
Yeah, I've had such a crazy adventure in the last few years. I'm so excited for this album to be out and about. Yeah.
And how did the recent collaboration then with Stormzy and Shawn Mendes come about?
Oh, it was a really unexpected combination, but Shawn and I sat together to write a song back in 2021. It was the gestation of the idea, and we sort of bonded over our love of communal music making, because music has this unbelievably powerful ability to sort of glue people together, you know? Mm. And so we wanted to write this song that felt connective and felt joyous and human and vocal. And so, and we also both just love gospel music so much. So I reached out to my good friend Kirk Franklin. He was like one of the most iconic living gospel musicians. And then I took the song to Storms, and he put that icing on the cake, and it was a joyous escapade.
I love that. Storms.
Storms. I noticed that.
Like, really quickly, I'm rehearsing this. What is that on your neck? Is that another instrument?
Yeah, it's an ocarina.
Brilliant. Yeah. Of course it is. Jacob, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Jesse Volume 4 is out next Friday, and tickets for his UK Arena shows are out now.
And Jacob will be treating us to a very special performance of Witness Me from the album right here in the studio in just a minute over there. So, Jacob, if you would kindly go and get yourself ready.
Thank you.
So
nice to meet you.
Can't wait.
Whilst we prepare for that, Timothy, we've had so many questions, and we have to bring this up. It's 40 years... since Alf Wiedersehen Pet, right?
It's not, is it?
40 years. I have to ask, I mean, legendary show. What was one of your favourite moments?
Silence. There's hundreds of them. I mean, there was one when the first time when we went to Germany, we were all, you know, we'd only done a little bit. We went to Germany, and one of the first scenes was having to, with Gary, God rest his soul, Gary Holton and I were pursuing some Swedish air hostesses on my motorbike, and we had to go along a road in Germany, I've never been there before, and we're down a road and then into a ditch. And this is before it was obligatory to have a stuntman. Right. Now, the complication was that I hadn't passed my motorbike test.
There you are.
Oh, we can
so
see it.
Here it goes. Oh, there we are. That's us going straight in there, right? I'd only passed my motorbike test the day before in Oxford. That's the only place to get me an emergency one. So, literally, if I hadn't passed it, I wouldn't have been doing that.
I love it.
Oh, you're a big fan, Bonnie.
Oh, I remember it well. It was iconic. It was massive.
Yeah, it was so big. And we've got some lovely questions. Thank you for these. Hannah asked this. Would Timothy ever like the opportunity to play Barry in Alf Wiedersehen Pet again?
I think we've done it enough now, don't you? I mean, they sort of do it occasionally, you know. Yeah. Dick and Ian, who wrote it, write sketches, and they do it sometimes up in a charity show. But I think, you know, I think never say never, but, you know, I think we had a good run.
That lovely.
Yeah, fair enough. Trisha asks, Bonnie, out of all the shows, concerts and musicals that you've performed in, do you have a favourite?
No, it would be like picking your favourite child. You can't. And, you know, there's so many different ones that... yeah, I couldn't pick one. I've been extremely lucky. And maybe that's the next one to come. I don't know. Made in Dagenham.
Oh. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Get it in there.
Yeah, for sure. Well, look, we've had so many wonderful comments as well. Helen has said this for Timothy, saying, love everything this man is in. Mm. One of my all-time favourites. And another one that we've got there from Hayley.
Hayley concurs.
That's lovely. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Absolutely. Hayley says, Timothy is a fabulous actor, so believable in everything he does.
Oh, yeah. Don't you love me crying in a minute? Thank you. That's really sweet of you to bother to.
It's been lovely to have you both with us tonight.
Thank you so much to all our guests. That is nearly it for tonight, but just before we go, we've got one more treat for you.
Yes, here to take us into the weekend with a special strip-back performance of his single Witness Me is the super talented Jacob Collier. Bye-bye.
You tell me you're broken. Tell me it's over now. Say your door open. Tell me all the lights gone out. Maybe you're lost at. Maybe you're far from home. If you only keep walking, you never will walk alone. Cause when I'm with you, there's nothing that I wouldn't do. You're the one that I waited for to bring out the best in me. I'm out in the blue, I'm holding my hand out to you. You're the one that I waited for, I'm holding on to you. I'm with you, I'm with you here. You're the light I need. In the dark I see. I'm with you. I'm with you here. You are all I see. You witness me. You've been searching and searching, but don't know. No more. You be searching and searching, but don't.